This is a picture of the celebration of TSMC's 30-year anniversary since founding. Over $4 trillion worth of company executives were there. TSMC, Nvidia, Broadcom, Qualcomm, ASML, and lastly, Apple. This is simply the most distinguished panel I've ever seen for a birthday party, and I think it captures the importance of the company lesser known to the public until 2018, when the trade war started. Then everyone started realizing how reliant the entire semiconductor industry is on TSMC.
The transistor in nightly transformed the electronics industry.
The transistor is a turning point in human history.
By the way, before we start, just a tiny plug for my newsletter, Disrupted. You may want to check it out in the link down below for a comprehensive industry primer on semiconductors. It will definitely help you understand the situation of TSMC better. All right, let's get back to the video. It's incredibly hard for us to fathom today how short it has been since the world's first semiconductor processor was invented. It was Intel 4004 and the year was 1971, exactly half a century ago. Semiconductor and the computer revolution were two sides of the same coin that fueled the first information revolution. Silicon Valley is called Silicon Valley precisely because of the semiconductors that were produced there in the early days. It's not the Internet Valley, it's not the Mobile Valley, it is the Silicon Valley. The 1970s were a time of tremendous growth and excitement. Some of the world's biggest technology companies were birthed or grew during this era. Intel, Micron, TI, Microsoft, and Apple, of course. First generation startups that changed our world. TSMC's founder, Morris Chang's career kickstarted during that phase. As a Chinese American living through the 60s and 70s, he knew his choices were limited. Graduated from MIT, smart, he started to dive into the semiconductor industry as a researcher. After 3 years at Sylvania, a small semiconductor company, he moved to Texas Instruments and rose quickly to become their group vice president overseeing their worldwide semiconductor business in 1983. He left the company after being told plainly that he is not going to be the CEO. That was 20 years after the semiconductor boom started. He went to Taiwan. He wrote the opportunity of the American industrial upgrade and thus shifting manufacturing to Asia. In 1987, at the age of 55, Morris took the leap of faith and started TSMC, based on an idea that has not been tested before. It's called a pure play foundry model.
The new business model, the pure play foundry business model.
Back in 1987, most players in the chip manufacturing industry followed what's called an IDM model, integrated device manufacturers. They integrated the design and manufacturing of chips into one company and do everything alone. These are the Intels of the industry. But what IDMs fail to see is that fabless innovation must happen in order for the industry to thrive. What TSMC basically did was to put forward a new playbook for all aspiring chip makers that we will build the foundries and manufacture chips for you, and you can focus on designing and selling the chips instead. We will worry about the heavy lifting and the manufacturing excellence, and you can be creative to design the chips that are necessary for next generation applications. Remember, this idea was years ahead of its time. Morris proudly called it,
"So it was a solution waiting for a problem to happen."
And luckily for TSMC, this problem happened very quickly. Qualcomm, one of TSMC's biggest customers, was founded 2 years earlier than TSMC, and Jensen Huang started Nvidia in 1993. But understandably, though Morris was an experienced executive since the founding, it was a very tough first 10 years trying to climb up the tech ladder. The company's valuation rose slowly. Seeing the promise of the fabless business model, many competitors enter the market. UMC was founded a few years earlier than TSMC. Vanguard opened their door in 1994 in the same science park where TSMC is located. It's important to mention that even as late as 10 years ago, TSMC was powerful but not nearly as dominant as it is today. It's clear from the revenues. One thing that forever changed the fate of TSMC happened in 2010 over a dinner at Morris House in Taiwan. an important guest was visiting. That was Jeff Williams. Jeff, of course, is then the COO of Apple. And if you don't know, which I doubt very much, Apple is the biggest company in the world that makes and sells iPhones. They were frustrated with Samsung, who makes their chips then. From Apple's perspective, by working with Samsung, they're investing into their top competitor in the industry. Apple must find someone else for its chip supply. TSMC was the best choice, because what Apple needed in a partner was the capability on the bleeding edge, but can scale with Apple to the hundreds of millions of units in delivery per year. That was the scale TSMC has never seen, and an enormous risk on both sides. TSMC invested $9 billion, and to have 6,000 people working around the clock on their very first project, a gigantic gamble. And of course, the gamble paid off. Here's the results. TSMC's revenue tripled over the coming years, and the market cap increased tenfold. This also pushed TSMC's technology to overtake IDM leaders like Intel and Samsung. TSMC has won decisively.
Glad I did it.
But in recent years, the struggle of TSMC has become a very different one. It's one that no for-profit company wants to be in. It's now stuck in between the two superpowers in a tug of war. The United States wants TSMC to stop working with the Chinese partners like Huawei. It did, and China did not blame it on TSMC, but it surely is very angry. Morris is confident of his ability to navigate the semiconductor landscape, but he believes that there are two wild cards that even he cannot fully comprehend: the oil states and China. The Saudis were one of them because they funded TSMC's biggest competitor, GlobalFoundries, when it spun off from AMD. When TSMC refused to work with Huawei, it became clear to China that it needed a powerful mainland alternative. The Chinese government have infinite deep pockets, and this is very worrying for TSMC. It is an incredibly thin rope TSMC is balancing on now. Looking back, TSMC were pivotal in spearheading the fabless foundry business model, and this has helped unleash many fabless companies from the capital-intensive manufacturing process. But looking forward, what type of technology is needed to continue TSMC's success? This still requires much discussion. The semiconductor challenges for smart devices were twofold. How can we make a small chip more and more powerful? And how can we make small chip more and more energy efficient? TSMC and its partners have answered that through its cutting-edge chips with more and more transistors, improving operational speed and energy efficient. But in the future, more and more challenges will come from the application side rather than simply focusing on the size. Artificial intelligence, Internet of Things, autonomous driving will need a different set of propositions from TSMC and alike to keep this industry exciting. And Morris and his story will live on with his company and this industry he helped build.